So in this lecture, I want to talk about the charge balance in the context of aqueous acid-base problems. So if we mix together all neutral species, those with no net charge, okay, even if they're made of ions, as long as the charges of the ions cancel, then the net charge of the mixed aqueous solution must always be zero. If we don't put any charges in, okay, without there being one positive for every negative, then if we don't add electrons to the solution or remove electrons from the solution, then that means that the net charge in the beginning must be the net charge in the end. Another way of saying charge balance is to say if you start with all neutral things, in the end, the concentration of cations or positive charged molecules will be equal to the concentration of anions or negatively charged molecules. So keep in mind, in every aqueous solution, we have the dissociation of water, which occurs according to its equilibrium constant Kw. Dissociation, I could also say autoionization or autoprotolysis. One water acts as a base and one acts as an acid to form hydronium and hydroxide. So we'll keep in mind, these two ions are always present. No matter how acidic or basic the solution is, there's always some hydroxide and always some hydronium. That has to be true for Kw to be defined. What you want to do is think about what other ions are present for each acid or base. So here we have nitric acid, right? That's going to dissociate with water to give hydronium and nitrate. So the cations in this solution are hydronium. That's the only one. It's coming from nitric acid. It's also coming from a small part due to water's dissociation. And we also have an anion, nitrate, and another anion, hydroxide. Now, you don't count the hydronium separately, right? All the hydronium is indistinguishable as to whether it came from nitric acid or water's autoprotolysis. It doesn't matter. But that cation is going to be equal in concentration to the addition of the nitrate and hydroxide concentrations, right? For every one positive charge, you have to have one negative charge. So this proves that the hydronium concentration is greater than the hydroxide concentration, because it's equal to hydroxide plus something, right? Or that proves it's acidic. The pH is lower than 7 when that hydronium concentration is greater. Okay, so in water, barium hydroxide is going to turn into barium divalent cation and 2 hydroxide ions. So this time we're introducing a new cation. So now in this solution, we have 2 cations. We have barium and we have hydronium. And we just have 1 anion this time, hydroxide. Okay. And the hydronium is coming from water. The hydroxide is coming from barium hydroxide and a little bit of water. And each of these has a positive 1 or a negative 1 charge. But notice this is the first time we've seen a non-unity charge. We have a 2+ charge. When you have any charge other than 1, you must make that charge the coefficient as well. Okay. And this may seem counterintuitive, but it will take 2 of these hydroxides to cancel every 1 barium, because barium has 2 charges. So the amount of hydroxide is equal to 2 times the amount of barium. Okay, so be sure to bring that charge down as a coefficient if it's not 1. Finally, sodium phosphate, I should say Na3PO4. So in water, this is going to dissociate from sodium, and it could pick up a proton any one of three times, because there are three negative charges, you'll find there's three KBs, and this weak base can turn into monohydrogen phosphate, dihydrogen phosphate, and then fully protonated phosphoric acid. So these polyprotic ones, it's a little bit more difficult to write the charge balance equation. We're going to ignore phosphoric acid because it's neutral. So it does not go into the charge balance equation, although it would affect the mass balance. So we have some new anions in solution. Phosphate, hydrogen phosphate, and dihydrogen phosphate. We have two cations, right? Sodium from sodium phosphate and hydronium, which comes from these acids in water. And the addition of those two cations, each with one positive charge, will equal the sum of all of the anion concentrations. Phosphate plus monohydrogen phosphate plus dihydrogen phosphate. One more thing, notice that there are two charges here. Let me write them more clearly. Phosphate and monohydrogen phosphate, these each have some non-unity or greater than one charge. So it will take three hydroniums to cancel every one phosphate. So the amount of hydronium is equal to three times the amount of phosphate. And you'll need a two out front of the monohydrogen phosphate for the same reason. All of the others are either negative one or positive one, and therefore they don't need a coefficient. Okay, so expect one of these charge balance problems on your first analytical exam, especially for polyprotic acids and bases. For more practice with the charge balance, and for mass and charge balance in general, for both strong and weak electrolytes, you can visit Unit 1 of my analytical course guide at chemguides.com.